Unfortunately, Oana Rapti is feeling rather unwell today, so she will not be able to join us. Also, the author of the book, George Calandia, will not be able to join us again. But a colleague of George, Nucci, will be able to join us today. And as you can see on the screen, currently appears the name of George, but here is the name of Nucci for those who would like to follow this presentation on textile from Georgia. So Nucci, the floor is yours.
Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. Firstly, I want to thank you for giving us opportunity to introduce very interesting book to a bigger audience. This project means a lot to us, therefore we can't be more thankful. Sadly, author of the book, as you said, Professor of Historical Sciences, George Calandia, also Director of Museum of Art Palace of Georgia, won't be able to be here today with us. But I, Nucci Kaçakhidze, Head of International Relations Department, will gladly present our work called Textile from Georgia. I want to show you the book, how it looks. This is our book, and it's pretty heavy. So about the book itself, the royal crown has always been prominent part of the vestments of Georgian kings. And the theme of headwear has been of interest to many Georgian scholars. The main goal of this work is to provide a comprehensive study of the topic as well to fully define the stages of development. In the project we have used, an original method to thoroughly study the subject. So members of the creative team sketched both crowns and other types of headwear shown in the frescoes of almost all important Georgian churches and monasteries, after which these drawings were compared with other types of visual material, miniatures, engravings, sketches, etc. They were chronologically sorted and prepared for publication. The pictures and scholarly text itself illustrates how in Georgia the forms of headwear developed and changed according to the influence of different civilizations, but they still kept their originality. From medieval Georgian written sources, as well as from coins, patterns of goldsmithing, and especially fresco paintings, it has been possible to restore both the crowns of the Georgian kings and queens and other headgear worn in Georgia. As in other monarchical states, the king's crown was a symbol of power, as you know, often carried distinctive symbol, meaning in Georgia. So about the project itself, we are very proud about this project, so I want to say a few words about it. Textile from Georgia was really an impressive and ambitious research project, and it started in 2016. And this project aimed to investigate the long history of Georgian textiles, to resurrect forgotten craft techniques, and to transmit knowledge of these techniques to a contemporary society. The study has revealed the close relationship between Georgians and wider region of Caucasus, as I said, and the influence they had obviously on each other. So the scientists, artists, and restorers involved in the project studied royal garments and illustrated representations of textile painted on more than 300 frescoes on the walls of Georgian churches and monasteries. The frescoes then were digitized, the costumes repainted, and data was analyzed. So because of this method, we were able to create a big database, and actually these unique historical fabrics were really important to us, because these graphic models were then transferred into different types of fabric, and then the restored textiles were sorted chronologically from 8th century to 20th century, and photographed, and that's how the database was created. The result shows the origins of textiles in Georgia and the Caucasus, describing its development, as well as further illustrating its links and parallels with Europe and also Asia. The research has been compiled in bilingual catalog, Textile from Georgia, this book I showed you before. And in addition to preliminary research, several unique historical Germans dated to the 18th and 19th centuries have been conserved and restored. I really want to talk a little bit more about barriers we met during this project, because our team actually has faced different obstacles. For example, there was not enough historical sources about textiles and overall material which scientists were studying, because of the research process was itself very hard and precise. Also, scientists tried to do an exact textile manufacturing technology research that was used during Middle Ages. For that, we had to consult with specialists that were working in this specific field, and they are actually not many of them. One of the aims of the project was to fully understand how the textile was made and what kind of technologies and material people used back then. And since we didn't have much information about such process, reconstruction of full manufacturing took a long time and hard work. But the change and impact the book had on our society was really good, because it is worth to mention that implementing the project Textile from Georgia and then creating the book itself boosted the idea of developing creative production. For this reason, the Art Palace of Georgia and the Ministry of Culture have actively cooperated on the topic to commence production and manufacture of historical textile, which will create new workplaces and increase the role of art and economic development of our country. So the book itself has revealed the close relationship between Georgians and the wider region of the Caucasus. It is very important to know your roots, to be able to fully understand the culture and the traditions. One very important thing that we learned through this project was the cultural heritage is not only the past that lies in the history books and cultural monuments, but also it takes big part in our Georgian modern society and everyday life. So we are really happy to be able to present this book today. The introduction was brief, but because the author itself is not here with us. But if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer them all.